I must confess that that dream that I had that day has at many points turned into a nightmare. Now, I'm not one to lose hope. I keep on hoping. I still have faith in the future. But I've had to analyze many things over the last few years, and I would say over the last few months. I've gone through a lot of soul searching and agonizing moments. And I've come to see that we have many more difficult days ahead, and some of the old optimism was a little superficial, and now it must be tempered with a solid realism. And I think the realistic fact is that we still have a long, long way to go.
And when I hear that statement made from over 49 years ago, it gives me the shivers because it's 2016, and it sounds like he just watched the news last night.
Action.
Do you feel just as unsafe around white cops as you do around some shady black people?
Repeat the question.
Breaking news in Newport News. Police have confirmed an officer shot one person in the city.
So, do you guys ever want to be a white person?
No.
Well, I did once.
I used to want to.
Because they got good hair.
I like white.
Two other people were found dead inside a van near 14th and Wickham. The person shot by police was taken to the hospital.
There's so much more going on in the world, but we're still, like, killing each other in our own community. Especially black-on-black crime, a lot of people shooting each other when we got cops shooting at us. So how we hope to survive if the cops are killing us off and we killing ourselves off?
The other side is working to get answers after a police officer shot and killed a suspect overnight in Newport News.
I think as white people, it's very easy to be unaware and to be ignorant, and it's not because, you know, it's always that people want to turn a blind eye. It's sometimes that if you don't know, then you just don't know.
They showed officers the gun. That's when police say one of the officers fired. Newport News Police Chief placed that officer and two others on administrative leave.
Do you think that a lot of white people hate black people or minorities?
No.
My name is Pandora Carter, one of the owners of Eagles Nest Learning Center. Me and my mom, Bessie Parker, owns three daycare centers in Newport News, and one Eagles Institute, which work with teenagers. We work with over 400 kids in Newport News. Working with kids, you get to see all different types of personalities and traits in kids that you can see that they have the potential to be somebody and do what they want to do when they get older. I had took the kids on a walk, and I asked the kids, I said, what do you want to do when you grow up? One of the kids said that he wants to be robbing and stealing. I told this child, I said, well, you're going to have to talk to your parents because they're going to need a lot of money to get you out of jail. And this child says, I'm not afraid of no police. This little boy that told me that he wanted to be robbing and stealing, prior to that, I used to hear him recite who's all of the presidents, and I realized how smart he was. I needed to show him that there was a different world out there other than robbing and stealing and gang banging. So I called Quan and I said, Quan, I said, I need to do a video with these kids. Quan said, I have the perfect person that shoot videos. He said, is this guy named Chip and Max.
My name is Tristan Jackson. I'm a cinematographer, video director, documentary filmmaker. At the time when Pandora first called me, I was in Texas with an artist named Ink and her band Vintage Nation. When I called Max and told him the conversation that me and Pandora had about shooting a video with the kids in the program, he was really excited because Max had been a football coach at Boys Club and he had worked with a lot of young people in the community, and he was always trying to get me involved, like, come on, man, we gotta go do something with the young people, we gotta show them this camera, because Max always noticed, being a football coach, that every child was not going to be an NFL football player, and there are a lot of options out there. And the main objective with the young people is choices and options, and providing options to give them choices.
And so Max came to the daycare center, And Max says to me, we could take these kids everywhere. We could take them bowling. We could take them to Chuck E. Cheese. And I tell Max, I said, no, that isn't what we need to do for these kids. We need to show them that there's other jobs out there that they can go and do and be successful, and they don't have to be robbing and stealing.
How many hours do you work a week?
They are the ones that's gonna have to figure out what the priorities are. What they think they need to pay next, what they need to do, what they need to get. And at the end of this, we're gonna process it, okay?
Yeah.
So y'all, we all need this every day. We're gonna make it real for them, okay? You have your check. This is your monthly, what you have. You have bills to pay. You have things to do, things to get. When you walk into the other room, each table is labeled of things that you know that you need to either pay or get. You have to go to every table. You have to
for somebody to tell you. You don't have to wait for a book to show you. You don't have to say, well, I know that I should do 1, 2, 3. Well, what about if I do 3, 2, 5? And I'll still achieve the same result. And that's the conversation that Chip, right? That he just had. It's about thinking out of the box.
Chip comes along and Chip says, I have this perfect singer, songwriter in Atlanta. Here's the perfect song for Give It A Try.
So throw your palms up.
Took all these kids out, and the success of the whole program was the looks on the kids' faces once they did see doctors' offices, firefighters, race car drivers. You could see that their minds was clicking, that there's a whole different world.
Dane, Max, and myself, we go to D.C. to shoot a short film called Brick Alley with Justin Kennedy and a child actor named Darius Caleb. He's done some films and some Broadway plays like Lorraine Hansberry's Raising of the Sun and Annie. They were real excited and enthusiastic about shooting the film, and they were really into the acting process. And it's always fun to see young people when they see themselves back on the camera. On the way back from D.C., we came up with the name F.A.M.M. Project, Future Actors and Movie Makers. So time passes, we bring Pandora the idea for the F.A.M.M. Project, and she brings us in to do a summer program with CBN. And days before our class starts with the kids, the worst thing happened.
Tonight, police continue to look for the person responsible for the death of a father who fought to end violence in a local community.
Police say someone shot Charles Sharp in the east end of Newport News last week. The 34-year-old died yesterday after his family took him off of life support.
Brian Farrell found out that the former sailor spent much of his time working to keep children safe.
Sharp's sister tells us from what she understands her brother was visiting friends in the East End. Although he did live in the city, he didn't live in this part of it, but spent time coaching Pee Wee football. He also was putting together a documentary showing some of the positive things children in the East End are doing. His sister says Sharp got involved in programs with young people, hoping to steer them away from violence, trying to change the perception many have of the East End. His own child, a 12-year-old daughter, left without a father after someone violently ended his life.
After we lose Max, I'm kind of at a crossroads. It's too many people getting killed in Newport News. It's too wild. It's too violent. It's too close to home. We was curving away from the music videos because of the violent influence. Then we get to doing something positive, and then this happens. So I'm really kind of like just ready to leave Virginia. And Pandora and other people around that's close reminded me that we had started something and we had to go ahead and finish it for Max.
We understand it's a crime problem with a lot of young people, and most of that crime is really caused by poverty and having too much time on your hands. We just try to be a good role model and showing the youth what they could be doing with their time, what they could be doing to make some money outside of being destructive. They can be creative and still make some money and have a good time doing
it. All my friends signed up for CBN and they were all talking about it. And I was like, I didn't want to be left out during the summer. Our moms talked and my mom signed me up for CBN and I did the interview thinking I'd end up getting it. Everybody has different sites. I work at FAM. And I do 5 hours a day.
All right, well, FAM, for the FAM project, stands for Future Actors and Movie Makers. And basically, what they do is teach us how to edit, be producers, be directors of movies or short films in general.
I start at 9:30, but I always go early. And I get out at 2:30. It really goes by fast most of the time because I'm having fun and I'm doing something that I like to do.
And what they do is they make music videos, but what we're doing right now is we're making a documentary.
Just working with Chip, they're actually teaching us how to become an actor, director, and producer.
It's important for me to be able to relate to them like a young adult that I am, just so they can realize that it's okay to be different. It's cool to be creative. Like, the arts are really where it's at.
And in that documentary, we have three people, actors, producers, directors, and people to edit everything. So honestly, just teaching us all about the film industry and how to be, you know, a leader pretty much. Because in the director, you can't just sit there. You have to tell people what to do, where to go, and it's pretty much your show.
With FAM, I work with cameras, and it's awesome. Our site is at a daycare. So sometimes we go on field trips with the little kids, and I really enjoy working with them.
It's fun. I like it. It's something new.
Yeah, I never thought I would like camera.
FAM Project has inspired me in a way because I make beats now. I'm a producer, and I've always wanted to learn how to edit music videos because, you know, a lot of artists need music videos to kind of get out there more. So it inspired me to pursue movie making and editing music videos. Because that all ties into what I'm doing, music and the industry in general.
It's better than just staying at home for the summer.
Yeah.
And we really gonna be in a movie?
So first we in the classroom, hitting the books, teaching them the basics of filmmaking, the different types of films there are, different shot styles, interview skills. We hit the road, take the kids on a few field trips, take them to see the big studios and how the pros work. I call up a few of my industry friends. Then organize a string of workshops for over 70 students from Hampton and Newport News City Schools just to teach them the basics of filmmaking.
This is Kenny Hopkins. Y'all know y'all favorite channel, WHRO. He shoots the same for WHRO. Can you go ahead and let him know what's going on?
So yeah, so that's kind of funny. So how many of y'all watch WHRO?
See, I tell them.
So we kind of have a joke at WHRO that our target audience is either like 0 to 6 years old or 60 to when they hit the grave. So that's kind of part of why I got hired was to take what the content that we were known for doing through our PBS affiliate and taking it from the television to the web.
We have a scene that we have to convey to shoot, and the people that can act are the people that can read and can remember their lines and can deliver their lines. With sincerity.
You get to shoot, you get to act, you get to do all the kind of things that it comes to making filmmakers. You can't always go to film school. So from the smallest thing of holding a boom mic, believe it or not, if your sound isn't right, the whole project doesn't work out, to acting, to doing acting exercises. So the first thing I did was get in a class with the kids and get them warmed up, have them moving around and getting loose. And then seeing who can memorize, you know, who can remember things, who can read lines and remember them.
You gotta study the line, memorize the line, and give it some life.
I got number four.
We gotta remember it.
Yeah.
We can't use the paper.
No.
Oh, I wanted the biggest one.
You never seen nobody in the movie pull a paper out?
I got number four.
Because they be having the notes right there. I know that.
Nah, they study their script.
And this setting here was a unique setting, an opportunity to actually do exactly what you're saying, and that is to have them look at what they want to do. Some of the kids that were in the group didn't even really want to participate in film. So I asked them the question. I said, how many of the kids here want to start businesses? And quite a few of them raised their hands, said they'd like to start businesses. And I showed them how being part of the film industry and providing services for the film industry, one young lady wanted to start a clothing store. And I was telling her that you can provide clothing for actors and that type of thing. That's a way for your business to be successful being involved in the film industry. You don't have to be an actor or producer or what have you. There's other components that are that where revenue is generated because of film and that type of thing. So if she wasn't aware of it, I know that kind of was a thing, that a light went off that, well, maybe this is something that I should be pay more attention to. And she really actually became more involved in the question and answer segment of her film.
Mr. Person, he really did inspire me a lot because like he's from here and he works with like a lot of movie stars and stuff, and he produces his own movies and stuff. So it kind of like, it gave me something like maybe if I was... didn't know exactly what I want to do when I got older, that would be something that I could look into.
Knowing where they come from, knowing what the political climate is, knowing what the racial climate is, knowing what the community climate is here in Newport News and how we're perceived across the country, that's a weight that kids shouldn't have to bear, but for whatever reason they have to bear it. So the questions that I asked were designed to kind of give them some help and understanding that this will pass. And if you have the right attitude, you will make it through this. There's, you know, don't worry yourself about things you can't control. Focus on the good things you can do. Focus on your day-to-day. Focus in on you. Make yourself
well,
better.
I'm definitely here to... set an example to be part of the solution instead of part of the problem. There's so much going on, so much you know, racial tension in the world and so much political tension. Instead of kind of focusing on the negative parts, I figured that we should just kind of get in and get our hands dirty and start to heal people through art, which is really what it's all about. Art is you know, very cathartic. And so instead of spending a lot of time in the boardroom talking about what we can do to make change, I'm more of the mindset that we just kind of jump in and get our hands dirty and start to do it, start to create, start to grow, inspire, show people that there are other things that they can do with their time. So that's why I'm here. I really love what I do.
So at the completion of the workshops, the field trips, and the little book work, learning some of the technical side, our FAM Project students decided to create a documentary and go off into the community and create a dialogue with their peers and other members of the community to see what issues that they're faced with today in 2016 and what can they do about them. So with the help of Damian Patterson, Devon Austin, and Gerard Bell, we organized the students into three groups responsible for producing and creating their original film. The production team include executive producers that learn the business of finding and marketing the film, the creative team that learn to write, shoot, and edit the documentary.
How are we gonna fix police brutality when we can't even fix ourselves?
Why is it so hard for us to love one another if we're all the same race, the human one?
All lives matter, not just black lives.
We need our lives to matter first.
We need more programs to keep the youth active, because if I wasn't here right now, I'd be sleeping.
If there was more opportunities for us, there would be less time for us getting in trouble.
There's too much violence in our community. The change starts here.
Civil rights movement isn't over yet.
We need more people to step up and be leaders in our community.
Less job opportunities is the reason why our people is out here killing, robbing, and stealing for money.
The circumstances of one's birth does not determine who you are. It is what you do with it is what makes you who you are.
Since when has being black become a crime?
We know the problems. What's the solution?
Did anybody ever ask us how we feel?
No!
Back on Midday with breaking news in Newport News. Police have confirmed an officer shot one person in the city. Two other people were found dead inside a van near 14th and Wickham. The person shot by police was taken to the hospital.
Breaking news, an officer involved shooting in Newport News. We have just learned the victim is an 18-year-old male.
Newport News, where police say they shot a suspect at an apartment complex.
10 on your side is working to get answers after a police officer shot and killed a suspect overnight in Newport News. Police say 23-year-old Jamal Beattie carried a stolen sawed-off shotgun. When he showed officers the gun, that's when police say one of the officers fired. Newport News Police Chief placed that officer and two others on administrative leave. Newport News Police will conduct two.
So what are your thoughts on some of
the recent events going on in the United States?
You know, we're all very concerned in law enforcement, you know, not only about the, you know, the senseless killing of our brothers and sisters in Dallas and most recently in Baton Rouge, but also the unfortunate incidents between citizens and police officers that we've seen, not only over the last few weeks, but just over the last few years. I think technology has allowed us to really see what is going on in our streets, and it does raise concerns. But I think overall, especially here in the city of Newport News, I think we've done a really good job of outreach and building relationships, not only in the community, but with the faith-based community between law enforcement. So I think that we have a good relationship here with the community in the city of Newport News, but it can always be better.
I feel a little bad.
I feel sorry for everybody.
I feel bad for the people around here, but like, it's not really an issue in Newport News.
Cause you get used to it.
Yeah, we used to it.
What, getting shot by cops, that's not an issue?
Not really in Newport News. I think the issue in Newport News is
getting arrested for crimes,
though. That's the issue in Newport News, because,
black people care.
Police is acting like they're scared of the black people. Like, I'm just speaking real truth. The white police are acting like they're scared of the black people. Like, they can't just put them down. They have to use a gun and kill them. Like, that's not how it works. If you're scared of a black person, then cut your job, don't be a police.
Police are just like really trigger happy.
Why do you think that?
I don't know, like, when they get their guns, I mean, maybe a little excited.
As a bishop, what is your relationship with police?
My relationship with the police is a great relationship because most of the police that I've come in contact with, supported down through the years, are great people, and they care about the community, and they are involved in the community in a way that they want to help, and they signed up for the job because they wanted to be a help to the community.
I think that it's wrong both ways for the officers to be, I guess, targeting black men and black women, but I think it's also wrong for us to go out and try to kill those who have done
that. Oh, I feel like they focus on the black community and black people specifically. Like, if they see one walking down the street, they're gonna, of course, look at the side and just see if they're doing something suspicious.
I think there's a lot of racial bias in the police force.
Some African-American / black people would stop being so thuggish all the time. Police would stop assuming stuff.
White people are thugs too.
Exactly, but they don't show it. They don't always walk around with their pants below their waist.
Am I in the shot?
Fake designer belt somewhere.
Every society and every group, you got some bad apples. And the tendency of the media and the tendency of people to blow those incidents out of proportion. It's almost like they capitalize on the 5% that's bad and ignore the 95% of what's good. And I think part of that is perspective on the media. While the problem does exist, I think we add to it by magnifying it and trying to find the problems and bringing that to the forefront of everybody's attention rather than the positive and the good things that we do in the community.
Me personally, I'm not scared of police. They're here to serve for us, to protect us. So if I'm threatened by them, who do I have to go to?
Feel protected by authority?
Hell no.
Hell no. They assume that all police officers are bad when they're not bad. They make bad decisions.
I do not feel like I'm protected by authority.
Does an action, they blame rest of the people that seem similar to him. Like, for instance, one cop's corrupt. Everyone else thinks that most of the police force is corrupt.
Not all cops are bad. I think that the stuff that's happening on the news, it puts a bad reputation on them, put a bad reputation on their names. So sometimes I feel nervous, but I'm not no bad kid. I'm not worried. Like they gonna pull off on me, but on the back of my mind, I'm thinking that, wait, maybe they will. So I'm even gonna back up my shoulder just in case.
I think that they probably just deep down really don't like us. So they feel like since they have authority that they can do pretty much whatever they want and get away with it.
How do you personally feel about the Black Lives Matter movement?
You know what, I definitely understand the movement. I understand the frustration and the fear and the anger that is out there right now. And I think it's really and it's on both sides. And I think the dominating emotion in that movement and also with law enforcement is fear right now. You know, fear is definitely that shared emotion where we say, you know, folks from the Black Lives Matter movement are afraid that when they leave their homes that they're not going to come back, you know, and this, also with their children. And I think police officers are in the same boat, that when they leave their home that night or during, you know, before they start their shift, that their wives, their husbands, their brothers, their sisters, their children are afraid they're not going to come home.
Pull in, we're on 28th and West Avenue. I pull in, I go to the cul-de-sac. Now, mind you, when I come in to go to the cul-de-sac, I see no one out here. You know, it's just a regular day. When I go to the cul-de-sac and turn around, by the time I turn around, there's a bike in the middle of the street with someone on their knees. Now, I don't know that the man is pointing a gun at me. So I'm coming up, and I don't know it's a police officer. So when I get up, I recognize that it's an officer. Automatically put my foot on the brake, put my hands up. What's going on? Boom. So we had a standstill for like 10 minutes because they saying, put the car in park and roll the windows down. I'm like, man, I ain't doing none of that. Y'all see me, right? Y'all see me. So, you know, this goes on for a minute. So they take the batons and start trying to break my window, saying that I'm not complying. When I'm only scared. Like, I'm not taking my foot off no brake and putting my hands down. Are you crazy? The cop in front shot first. My first initial shot hit me in the mouth and ripped my mouth off. The second shot hit my arm. This is what I'm doing. The third shot, he can't break the window, so he has to shoot the window out. But in the midst of that, he's shooting me. Now, they added insult to injury when they handcuffed me, bro. Three different officers, but only two shot. One testified that he did not see probable cause to shoot the same cop that was fired.
Crazy, because I mean, there's so much more going on in the world, but we're still like killing each other in our own community, especially black on black crime. A lot of people shooting each other when we got cops shooting at us. So how we hope to survive if the cops are killing us off and we killing ourselves
when
off?
I hear Black Lives Matter, of course my mind goes to like police brutality, but at the end of the day, we can't get to that point like working on the issue at hand unless we check ourselves, because we killing ourselves. So
I had an uncle, well, he's not like by marriage, but not anymore, they divorced, but we still treat him as an uncle. It was a while back, a few years back, but his house got robbed and his daughter was sleeping in her room, so he locked the door and whatnot, and the people came in and they shot him and he died.
My cousin Jafari had got shot and killed. He was with one of his friends. He had just left church. And he was with one of his friends, and one of his friends was like, yo, I'm about to go rob this dude. So he was like, all right, I'm not about to be there when you do it. So he walks away. But like, they were so close, so when he did it, like, he had went up to the dude, and my cousin ran, because he was like, I'm not about to be here when you out here robbing people, because he pulled out a gun, but turns out it was a BB gun, to try to rob the guy. So when my cousin was running, the guy had shot him instead of the dude who robbed him in the back, and my cousin had bled out. But yeah, he died.
So I mean, I guess it's lots of different ways you could take Black Lives Matter, but when I think of it, I just think like how we need to improve ourselves.
More people, even young kids, are getting their hands on weapons that they shouldn't have, and innocent lives are being lost, and people are dying every day just because somebody wants to be trigger happy or go around shooting random people.
I feel like we got a lot of unnecessary gun violence that needs to stop, because it's all over petty stuff, and it's ridiculous.
So we need to control gun violence, because gun violence is starting to get out of hand before somebody just walks in schools and starts shooting like they already did. So if we don't control gun violence now, then it's just going to be like the purge, and everybody's going to start dying, and people are just going to start shooting at random people. Because there's a lot of evil in the world for no reason, especially nowadays. Like, nowadays, everybody wants to kill somebody for some reason. So, yeah, we need to control gun violence.
They say Black Lives Matter because they're protesting, but then everybody's like, oh, everybody's lives matter. So how do you feel about that?
I mean, yeah, everybody's lives matter, but right now, they are messing with Black people. Like,
then again, everybody's lives does matter.
Black lives matter, but it's really about the Black people right now.
Yeah, we're just focusing on Black people because of what happened.
Because police really don't mess with white people like that. It's more blacks.
I
I feel like everybody who's saying all lives matter is mainly people who don't know what it is to be black.
Can I interject, please?
Go ahead.
It's not just black people matter. They're saying all lives matter. Mm-hmm. So you just can't go outside.
Okay,
and kill
but
somebody.
Right now, they only saying that because they feel like they're obligated to say that all lives matter. And they feel like we point out exactly one race.
You can't really go telling people about how much you mean if you really don't mean it to yourself, to be honest.
Mm-hmm. You can't be fussing about Black Lives Matter when you're doing black on black crime. You can't. Mm-hmm.
Have y'all known anybody that's been in the gang, or have you lost somebody due to gun violence?
Yes. I know people that are in the streets, but I always try to tell them the right way to go. Because if your mother gets that phone call, your son has been shot. Why? Because he's been in the street. So I always tell them that you don't want your parents to be mourning over a loss because of you wanting to be in the streets. So get in somebody's classroom, get an education.
Or you guys think that people join
to get better popularity around the community so they won't get killed by gangs. So they just join the gang so they don't get killed by gangs. Mm-hmm.
They feel like they in a family. Mm-hmm.
They in the street so deep that they can't just get out by what my words say. So I mean I be like friend and stuff. I'll join them.
It's easier to get in the gang can I'm probably than it is to get a job.
Why do you think it's so popular for our generation to be involved in the streets?
Mainly because the examples that are set before us, like the music that we listen to, all they do is, gang-related, short weed. They think it's cool, they think that's the norm. But really, you should be, like I said, getting education, being more than what people expect you to get.
If we kill each other, then it seems like we don't care about living or not. So that's what makes them feel like, okay, we can kill whoever we want now, since especially black people, since they kill the most of each other than everybody else. That's how I feel.
Black Lives Matters, we have to matter to each other. And while we are talking about Black Lives Matter, let's stop killing each other. Let's stop having our grandmothers and grandfathers scared to walk down the street. Let's stop having our teenagers and young adults afraid to walk outside and can't even play in their front yard anymore because they don't know when somebody of their own color is gonna come by and shoot them.
Stop all the gangs and everything else and just come together as one and realize that we're all in this together. Mm-hmm. Nobody else is gonna help us but ourselves.
Everybody has to make their own choices. We can't really make anybody do something that they don't want to do, but we're just saying that it should be. Everybody should care about everybody. Black lives should matter to black people before we try to make it matter to other races. Mm-hmm.
You feel as afraid of when you see white cops as you do when you see shady looking black guy?
No, I feel the same. Cause shady black people, they shady. They always trying to do something, and then white cops, not all of them bad, so.
What are you more afraid of, the black person or the white cop?
I was a shady people. Because, I'm scared of white cops because you see them shooting people, but they're not always shooting people. So, some things, they might just arrest you for something, but you can get out. Shady people, they might just take you somewhere different that you never know how to get back home.
The things that separate us, I guess the way we act.
Go into a little bit.
Some people talk proper, some people don't talk proper. They kind of put you in a category. Somebody might be better than you because he talks proper, or the way he dressed, or the way people act and carry themselves. That's one thing that separates us in the community.
How y'all feel about the whole light skin versus dark skin thing?
We're all black!
Oh my God! We're all black!
If slavery came back, we all be slaves, so it doesn't matter.
So, do you guys ever want to be a white person?
No.
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 Well, I didn't want to.
I used to want to.
Because it got good hair.
I like Hawaii.
I used to not want to be dark skinned either. Like when I was younger, I remember, I think we went to the beach. And then I went back home and then I noticed I got 10 times darker. I started crying so hard. I was like, I don't want to be like this anymore. But then, I don't know, and at school and stuff, I don't know, all my friends are light skinned stuff, but sometimes.
Why didn't you want to be dark?
I don't know, it was just, it wasn't pretty. It was, even though my sister was pretty, I don't know. It wasn't something I wanted to be. It was ugly.
If you could change your skin color, would you?
No, hell no.
If I could change my skin color, would I? No. Today, I would not change my skin color if I wanted to. I'm black and I'm proud. But if you had asked me that question, let's say 5 years ago, I would have said yes.
I mean, I think everybody at one time wished they would be white. I wanted to be white so I can have blue eyes.
I'm a genuine soul brother and proud to be. And that's look, I take my head off on that one end.
I'm not gonna lie, when I was little, I used to always want to be light skinned because, like, the light skinned girls in my grade, when I was younger, they used to always get all the boys, always get on them, all that stuff. And then, yeah. But.
Light skinned life.
Light skinned life.
I came up with that myself.
I remember when they kept saying, like, hashtag light skinned versus dark skin, I remember that.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
That was, like, in eighth grade. When I was in eighth grade, then we kept doing, like, everybody was, like, switching up
Everyone of their women crush list is, and if it's a famous person, they're always
I personally don't really care about it because my dad is dark skinned, my mom is light skinned. I got a lot of dark skinned friends, light skinned friends. They ain't really matter to me. But I guess some people, a lot of people want to be light skinned. I don't know. I guess it's just like a stereotype that light skins are better or being light, get treated better. I don't know. I mean, but I don't really see a problem with it, but a lot of people do. Like, a lot of people always have beef or, oh, I don't like that light skin, oh, he dark skin, or, you know, he think he better than me because he lighter than me. Like little petty
sometimes
stuff
I
like that.
By it. Like, my cousin, he says that he prefers light skin girls over dark skin and said that dark skin is ugly when he himself is dark skin, and that, like, he says that he can't date a black girl, that he has to date a light skinned girl because, like, he says they're beautiful and that they're just perfect to him and whatnot.
A genuine soul, brother. And what it is.
And then, like, my friend, she has lots of friends and whatnot, and sometimes she FaceTimes them. And, like, she was talking to these boys, and she said, oh, I'm with my friend and whatnot, and the first thing they asked was, is she light-skinned? And, like, I didn't know how to respond to it, so I just walked away. But, like,
I used to, like, want to be light-skinned, because I was just like, oh, well, they got the good hair. But, like, I mean, I had good hair, too, so I really didn't find anything wrong with it. I was like, well, you know, well, I got good hair. I got, like, 13 sisters, so I just started looking at them like, well, they ain't all light-skinned. They're not all dark-skinned. I mean, some dark, some light. So I just, like, it's like, hey, everybody's
the same. She light-skinned, and she be thinking she all that. Just because she... Oh, just cause she light skinned, she be like, oh, Brianna, we be yelling at each other, and then she be like, Brianna, you just mad cause you black, and I be like, what are you talking about? That's why I like light skinned people, cause then.
And yeah, like boys and stuff, they like lighter girls, and even growing up around a lot of white people, all the white people like the other white people, but then I was just darker, so no one liked me.
Like when you go to school, people, they'll just like make comments about it, and then it like makes you feel bad. They're like, oh, I wouldn't be able to see you in the dark or something like that. And they just like start making comments.
We see at school and we watch videos of movies on TV. On a smart board, they set off the light, they're like, oh, where he go?
Right
at the light. He's standing right there. They're like, oh, I can see the white of your eyes or your teeth. I'm like, I know you can see him. He's not that black.
I wouldn't want to be light skinned. Because light skin, they all have a fear of the sun, and the sun comes out every day. I can't be afraid to go outside. It's pretty much it.
Right. But I do know a few black people, like
me.
Black.
I mean, light skin versus dark skin, there's not like much of a difference. Like people think there is. I think, cause like a lot of light skins, like they might be part white, and so like. You know, black people, they naturally just don't like white people. It's just been that way. And so I feel like that's where like a lot of the turmoil comes from.
Why has it been that way? Yeah, why? Why has it been that way?
Because, like, ever since white people, like, started slavery.
What are some struggles you have faced because of your race?
Life.
What I came to talk to you guys today about is your imagination, right? I came to talk about your identity, right? I introduced myself as Asa Jackson, right? But Asa Jackson is an idea and a concept, right? That's not who I really am, right? Y'all know really, what, 10th, 11th, 12th grade? Who took biology already, right? Who took physics yet? Anybody took physics already? One of the laws of physics, right? Energy cannot be created nor destroyed. When you learn in biology, everything, or chemistry, I'm not sure which class it is, you learn everything breaks down to a simple unit, which is the atom. So when you look at me, right, you see a young man, 27, African-American, all these concepts and labels you put on me looking at me, right? You might think I'm cool, you might think I'm whack, you might think I'm whatever, light skin, whatever. Whatever you may say in your mind, all ideas, right, that you're putting on a bunch of atoms. You hear what I said? Those are all ideas that you're putting on a bunch of atoms. Right? So I want you to think about that for a second. Because how often do you think of yourself as a bunch of atoms? Never, right? How often do you think of yourself as a walking group of atoms that can talk and think? Never, right? But let me tell you something. Every single thing you can see right now is atoms, right? Energy that has never been created nor destroyed, right? Every single thing you can see and not see, because it includes the oxygen and carbon dioxide in the air as well. Those are also atoms, right? And you're putting your thoughts on them, right? And they're molded and they become things. Now, thoughts are very powerful, and I'm gonna tell you
why. You guys are creating this whole reality with your thoughts. You're the one telling the world who you are. And the reason why you tell me that you're African-American young woman in high school is because that's what the world told you you are. The reason you told me that's your name is because your parents and everybody else told you that's your name. Because if you're made of atoms, and everything else is made of atoms, and atoms are communicating, right?
Then the thoughts you're putting out are technically communicating with all the atoms in this room and beyond this room, right? I'm not gonna go into the law of attraction because y'all are a little young, but I know some of Chip's students at the FAM Project been touching on that with Think and Grow Rich, right? The reason I'm an artist today is because when I was 16, I decided I was gonna be an artist and I didn't have a plan B. There was no plan B. There was no safe for me, right? Before I decided I wanted to be an artist, I wanted to be a basketball player. I probably wanted to be all types of crap, right? But when I found what I love, right, that's what I decided, that's who I am, right? And that's who I became. And every circumstance in my life, right, has molded around me to help me become a great artist, right? Because I put the seed of thought, right? The world will give you back what you want, but you gotta tell it who you are, right? So this workshop we're gonna do today is about identity. If I asked you, who are you? Who are you? What would you tell me?
What's your name, man? What's your name? Sweet Dennis. What's up, man? It's everything, it's everything. You do the get down today.
There is another class of colored people who make a business keeping the troubles, the wrongs, and the hardships of the Negro race before the public. Having learned that they are able to make a living out of their troubles, they have grown into the settled habitat of advertising their wrongs, partly because they want sympathy and partly because it pays. Some of these people do not want the Negro to lose his grievances because some of them do not want to lose their jobs.
Character, not the circumstance, makes the person.
Those who are the happiest are those who do the most for others.
I will permit no man to narrow and degrade my soul by making me hate him.
We should all rise above the clouds of ignorance, narrowness, and selfishness.
You can't hold another man down without staying down with him.
You can't hold a man down without staying down with him.
You can't hold a man down without staying down with him.
Those who are the happiest
are those who do the most for others.
Associate yourself with people of good quality, for it is better to be alone than to be in bad company.
Those who are the happiest are those who do the most for others.
I'll permit no man to narrow and degrade me by making me hate him.